ടീച്ചർ
അനന്തരാജ് സർ
സമയം
വിമൽ മാം എത്തിയിട്ടുണ്ട്
ശരി
യാ ഗുഡ് മോർണിംഗ് എവ്രിവൺ ഗുഡ് മോർണിംഗ്
ഗുഡ് മോർണിംഗ് മാം സ്വാഗതം ചെയ്യട്ടെ
ആ തുടങ്ങാം സാറേ
മിത്രോ സബ്കോ സാദർ നമൻ हमारे इस द्विसाप्ताहिक एफडीपी प्रोग्राम के समापन सत्र में आप सभी को स्वागत। हम इस सत्र के उपक्रम करेंगे रसतंत्र के प्राध्यापक नेशनल कोऑर्डिनेटर प्रोजेक्ट हेड एंड जॉइंट डायरेक्टर एमएचआरडी जीएडी टीएलसी एमएचआरडी डॉक्टर विमल राव रसतंत्र के प्राध्यापक प्रोज्वल व्यक्तित्व के धनी हमारे इस कार्यक्रम के सूत्रधारक आपका व्यक्तिगत परिचय तो आरंभ में ही अच्छी तरह से हुआ है। अब अपने विशिष्ट उद्बोधन के द्वारा हमें लाभान्वित करेंगे डॉक्टर विमल राव।
You are on mute, ma'am. Please unmute yourself.
बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया आनंद राज जी और सबको प्रणाम एंड गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। सो लेट मी जस्ट शेयर माय स्क्रीन एंड स्लाइटली आउट ऑफ कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ दिस एफडीपी बट आई विल बी शेयरिंग एज अ टीचर दैट हाउ नाउ द वीडियोस कैन बी ब्रिंगिंग दैट इंटरेस्टिंग फ्लेवर इन आवर टीचिंग लर्निंग which can be face to face in hybrid mode when we go back to normal and also in the purely online teaching or if we are trying to have online courses MOOCs and the creation of open education resources the plethora of now digital things are integrating in our higher education so as teachers I think whatever tips you have taken from professionals and other experts in this 2-week FDP you can integrate that and some ground level work I will say which we have done with the help of thousands of teachers across the country and in making some of the programs which are being appreciated now as one of the best programs at the national level by Government of India. So let me just share my screen and I hope my screen is visible.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So when we have first thing I would like to go into detail is that videos are now very very important part in MOOCs and online courses. So irrespective of the subject boundaries I am talking about but being a chemistry teacher I may take some examples to showcase what we have done with some of our subjects MOOCs Professor Bakshi has already introduced where you have massive number of participants and there is no pre qualification required any learner can learn from these so when you are having learners coming into this unless or until the quality is good MOOCs will not be successful and I think that is what the research also shows the quality of MOOCs is very very important otherwise just putting these resources just like the you look at the in the Bollywood and Hollywood and other regional movie sections also which movie is clicking which is really responding touching to the viewers requirement so here our in educational video I actually call it I don't know whether I have coined this word or not but edu-Hollywood so I refer to this that now we have to enter into the education professional video production in a very, very massive way. And even your one master creation can be hit like anything. It can reach across the boundaries and really make the impact. And that can be done in our core areas, in the curriculum, which is missing in our system, and also to do the handholding to our students in different ways. So around this, the gazette notification is already there since July 2016, but sitting in 2021 till date, this has actually not even reached to 20%, and now it is being increased to 40%. Why? Because first of all, as teachers, we are not aware. And another thing is we have to look at what all MOOCs are available on SWAYAM portal every semester and what all can be offered to our students in our own discipline. And then if they are not able to be offered, then can we use them in the hybrid or the blended learning in our own classroom teaching? That is another dimension that you have to look for. And another look you can see, many of the colleagues may find that, okay, there are no MOOCs for our subjects. Go ahead and grab these projects, try to prepare your own MOOCs, not only help your students, but also help other teachers and lakhs of students through that, because these are having very, very great shelf lives, unlike the Hollywood or Bollywood movie. So that's one difference that I will say, that in educational video, the shelf life is more, except a few topics which are very dynamic and maybe every year or every semester they have to be changed and upgraded. Also now the fully online courses, the programs, BA, BCom, MA, MCom, MBA type of degrees are allowed to be offered purely online. And this offers the lifelong learners a very, very great opportunity, but not that we will be simply giving the books like in open-ended education. So here the material, in addition to the text material, the video has been emphasized, and that is another dimension, because if you're not having a teacher in front, the best is, yes, the face-to-face teaching, and where you have the best of the tools also integrated, the hybrid model. But in the purely online form also, you can exceptionally do well if you have good quality content in the form of videos. Much, much better than the open and distance education courses, which somehow have got the second grading after the face-to-face system. And here all the e-content becomes very, very important. And e-content we define as the multimedia content. Although there are various formats of making this e-content, they can be HTML, 5 type of content, Flash is slightly outdated, then you have video content, you have interactive, JIPT, SCOM modules, API tin can formats. So there are various technical standards and how you put. But from the last decade, the emphasis has shifted more towards the video content because of the mobile phones being more economical and handy devices in our learners' hand, which also have better battery life. Because if you talk about the rural area where lights are not coming very often, so desktop and laptops take a back seat and mobile friendly content has to be there. And that's why now, in addition to PDFs and text and interactive quizzes, the video content, which put up the most interesting way how you can guide the learner in a virtual setup. But when we design this content, the visual appeal really makes a very, very positive impact, but at the same time, it can do a negative impact also. So as teachers who will be creating and using the ready-made content, we have to be very critical that the content that we are putting, if they are highly animated, flashy, so that will be really appealing. Good can be made into better, but bad can be made into worse. So if it is factually incorrect, then it will be having a negative impact as well. On the other hand, you may not be having any animations of these, then these type of videos we'll be just replicating whatever scenario or whatever standard we have in the existing classroom. No doubt there are peaks of excellence, but still at the global ranking, we are not able to reach to that excellence level, and excellence always keeps on moving, and it is a target that we always have to strive to keep on improving on. So if we have good stalwarts, subject experts writing on the board, that video will be just okay. If you are not having any better video, it will be serving some purpose, but then how you write on the board, sometimes that clarity is not there, the handwriting is not clear. So it has to be the best combination of the subject as well as the technical specific requirement. So unlike the Hollywood, Bollywood and other, here our subject takes prime importance, and that too has to be designed as the per the level of learner, and that's where the entire instruction designing comes. Very briefly, what I mean by that is how you put up the entire content, how even one video you make the storyboard. For example, if you are trying to make a content for 5th-6th class grade student, one may debate that these are not good, the print medium is good, but then I think we all know there are so many apps right from kindergarten. The students are learning in a fun way how ABCD and math, simple math calculation can happen. So if you're designing it for a 5th grade student and writing too much text and just speaking, it will be boring. They will shut down that video. But on the other hand, if you are putting some characters, some comic character, some maybe something from nature, so that will be really exciting them, and it will be a fun way. But the same if you try to put up the at the higher education level, it will be like, oh my god, this is so kiddish content, I'm not going. So you have to see really from the learner's perspective and then correspondingly design all the elements and put your learning outcomes into place and try to put up. Taking the example of EPG Parshala, where we have done a massive work at the national level, UGC gave projects for 77 subjects, and out of this 6 subjects came to us, and every subject the target was around 16 papers, and every paper had to be designed, so it was broken into 35 to 40 parts now, which is called as module. And now this has formed the standard for developing MOOCs also, that for every 4 credit paper, at least 35 to 40 modules having a total of 20 hours video and 20 hours of non-video content should be there in order to qualify in terms of giving it as a 4 credit for the education system. And then how the content can be formed is a 4 quadrant model. Very simply, for every module, you are having a video, which is self-learn or self-learning. Then there is a text, there are questions, and there are some additional facts which are like no more. So that forms the 4 quadrant for e-content. So video, you see, is very, very important here. And the same way, the MOOCs. So e-text and no more, all the written part, you put up separately or you combine them. That is the reference material which can be put up in a MOOC. Video is the same, fine. And then content of 4 quadrant is put up into week-wise, you get MOOCs, and weekly you mix and match the questions from modules of that particular week and make it as assessment quadrant. So that is one quadrant. And there is inbuilt feature where you can have the discussion forum. So, but today's, my focus of this lecture is not on these 4 quadrants. Those who want to know more, they can take up my other sessions. And the video part, if I say, it is very, very important in the 4 quadrant of the e-content as well as the 4 quadrant of a MOOCs. On the similar lines, I have prepared this teacher's e-kit 2.0, where also any flipped classroom video, if you have to use, give it to your students beforehand, and then in the classroom you want to discuss, that can be developed by you. And a group of teachers can approach me to complete one paper, and there will be full credit given by our center. E-content developer module will also give you APIs. Now, since when we started this EPG Pathshala project 2013, there were no such academic incentives for the teachers contributing. But now all of you can benefit in terms of academic incentive. So just like the publishing of research paper or books, I think research paper, there are 8 to 10 points depending upon our subject. But then here it is 5 per module. So contributing in 2 modules is equivalent to contribution to 1 research publication in terms of API, if we talk about. So that is a very welcome step which has been taken by UGC and Ministry of Education, where now as teachers we feel motivated. Otherwise also, I think without the points, I'm really thankful to the entire team of teachers who contributed at the time when there were no APIs, and now many of them are actually using these in their promotion requirement. So if you have to prepare these videos, entire e-content development methodology has to be understood in detail, because there are so many factors in terms of subject specific requirement, reviewing, plagiarism check, and also the technical specific requirements have to be done. But then many of we may argue that chalk and board is best. Are some of you missing your chalk and board right now? Yes. Can I see some answers? Any of you? Are you missing your chalk and board? You can write in chat. Yes. So, Mohideen sir is missing chalk and board. Vinita is saying in some classes. Okay. And Manjusha, Dr. Javier, yes. So we are, most of us are missing. I am not missing. I am rather trying to create more and more resources in this period, which otherwise there was less time, because going into the classes where sometimes is not possible recording because of the sound all coming up. But let me share that I am a kind of teacher who has not touched chalk since 1 decade. Surprising? Yeah, so I think we all should try to go into that direction, because what I feel is our efforts, they go waste when we are writing on board. And all, can we preserve it? Many stalwarts, the so-called, the best of the teachers, their efforts have been just gone. Yes, many of them have documented their intellectual expertise. Because see, when we enter our profession, we are not so experienced. But as we grow over the years, I think that wisdom that we get, the insights that we get in our subject, that should be then documented and preserved. And rather than the text document, I prefer if we create our own videos, which we can use for the future batch of students, and also we can keep on improving them and use in our classroom teaching as well, or for the flipped classroom model. And how do we prepare these videos in addition to so many other tools? Editing tools, uploading, compression, how you make it on YouTube or other of such streaming websites. It's also important to know that when we are making these type of videos, then PowerPoint is a very good tool, and that can be excellent as a storyboard for making the videos as well as your online classroom delivery or your hybrid classroom delivery. But then if you are taking these PowerPoints in a way where you are writing too much content, bad fonts, poorly contrasted site, images and videos also with poor quality, so all that are a bitter experience for the learner. So we have to be now critical about the presentations also, and very, very minute things in that. And also our subject context may be requiring like proper use of notations, even the spacing between the units and the magnitude and so on. So there are different aspects from different subjects, and I think we all of us know how it can be. And my language friends, definitely when how the Unicode fonts, because if you are using a Word doc as a script or PowerPoint, and then you give it to your technical person for making. If that language is not like Malayalam or Telugu or any other, then if the technical person is not having that language knowledge, then it will be copy paste, and then it will not be even visible to him whether he or she has done some mistake. This happened with me, one of the project I was working at Delhi University level, Punjabi subject. So the script which came to us for putting it into the video, when it was copied and pasted in the Final Cut Pro system, then for us it was good. But finally, when a Punjabi expert look up at, oh my God, this is horrible. This has changed its meaning and the type of fonts. So Unicode fonts and some small things which you have to take care, and then accordingly do the testing before it is uploaded. And while you are having these presentation in your classroom or otherwise for videos, please do not read whatever is written, because that becomes boring and your students will say, ma'am, sir, please give us this PPT. We don't require you anymore. So we should be using these tools to empower ourselves, not to replace ourselves. And that is what now is a new pedagogy which is evolving, that how with the help of these PowerPoints and the videos, you can be more interactive with your learners, and you can be really making that excitement in the class, bring back the question raising skills from the students, group discussions and so on. So the role of teacher is shifting. It's no longer the same classroom teaching that you will be doing on this mode, that we just derive the equation or we tell and then the students do the questions at the end. So that's what is a flip model, where you give them the information or the concept explanation video, and the students come prepared with that, and then you do a very thorough discussion with them, go into the insight, and that is what will bring flavor in our system and also meet the required learning outcomes as per the to the market forces for their employability and other skills required. Some examples I will like to quote here, because especially PowerPoint, I have seen 90% of the teachers, they know using PowerPoint, but you have to now be putting more media into it, more audio, more video, more visuals, animations, and make it more appealing and attentive to the learner. So like if you have to share this information in place of this, which is only text, slightly boring for the learner, I will put it into this format. It's not a comic character, but yes, it is making more sense now and making it visual appeal, that how with different wavelengths and frequency region, I can then go into one by one and elaborate and focus on the concept. My bio colleagues may be having different diagram, and similarly from literature and history. So much visual content is available now, or you have your smartphones, start clicking and putting in your PowerPoints and share with your students in what context when you're describing that. Okay, so there's no longer that black and white world of the blackboard where you make and then you rub and you again have to remake, and imagine you have to make again and again, 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 30, 40 years. My God, we are just wasting all those things. So my younger colleagues are really more fortunate than the senior ones, including me, who are having now these technology and more years to go ahead for their teaching learning environment, and they can really plan their interesting slides. Some more examples. So I'm talking about two molecules colliding, and then I am relating about the chemistry details. So there is definitely a more visual appeal and the students can relate. I have to deal with complex equations. Similarly, graphs or some others, you can now be imaginative in your own context subject. that how you can take it further. So put it into different colors, small parts, and then go into explanation. Animations and simulations, you can find plenty and search and try to mix and match with your context of teaching learning. Look at this animation. This is economics, but I'm sure all of us will be able to understand what it is talking about.
It's scorching heat and a person is really thirsty. He is willing to pay a good amount to get thirst quenching one glass of water. This is because he is getting immense benefit from this one glass of water. From the second glass of water, the additional benefit he derives is a little less than the benefit from the first bottle. Hence, he is willing to pay a little less for the second one. The economist's term for this additional benefit is marginal benefit. And so he derives even a little less benefit from third glass and would pay even lesser. This explains the law of diminishing marginal utility.
So see how this analogy and with the help of animation, this difficult concept has been made into a simpler one. Otherwise, the same if it is written in a paragraph, the students will just do the rote learning, try to just reproduce the definition, and even if they get 90% and all, they have not, doesn't matter. What you can do is, just a minute, I'll have to. Yes. So then you can also use the whiteboard feature, which is there. You can take the PowerPoint as a base with the writing pad, the small hardware, which are interactive tablets, or sometimes the laptops have the touch screen possibility. And with the screen capture tool and minute editing, you can create these type of things which we have been writing on our board in our own way. So look at this mechanism, which I very often use. I don't have to write it again. When I'm using in my PowerPoint, I will put off the audio and explain as per my, and then along with the audio, I can give it to my students so that they can learn at their own pace any number of times. So all these things are now possible to be integrated. And then when I'm making my video of online class or otherwise a professional one, then also I can integrate all these resources and make it very, very exciting. So audio video tools is another thing that we have to look up, that when we are creating videos, we should be looking at the entire visible to the learner and the sound. So it's a combination of sound, what we are speaking, some background sound if you want to add, some animation, some visuals. So entire package is there for the learner, and that is what is the educational video content production that you have to now prepare yourself. And the rather than taking one best technique, there's no best technique actually. So you have to better mix and match, and as per your topic and subject requirement, you can take combinations of these. But while you are putting text, please don't put small size. It has to be comparatively big, because this is not going to be shown on the projector or on the big laptop screen, but only on your mobile devices, and the students will be, most of the students, and especially from the economically weaker section, they will not be having even good resolution smartphones. So you have to look at the lowest market device in terms of price, with and then your video should be best in that also. Rather, so automatically the higher end will be taken care. So that is one more dimension that you have to keep. Then you can know about some technical terms around these videos. What is a frame? Nothing but just one of the many still images which we combine and give entire moving picture. There are frame rates, and depending upon that also the quality of video is there. You can have slow motion videos, you can have stop motion type or fast motion. So all these type of videos are possible. And then there are also technical terms in terms of the video resolution. Initially we had 480 SD, then 720 HD ready. Sometimes we'll find in the naming, or when you look at any website, you will find it, okay, you want to see in 720, 1080, even the YouTube has that option. So higher quality can be compressed, but lower quality cannot be enhanced. So while recording, you have, if you have the provision, then record it in the highest, and then accordingly you can compress into the lower resolution. But then one more thing here, it also, because if you're recording in higher, like 4K, then you will require more space for storage. So you have to somehow balance it. So 1080 is what I will say is something that we should be minimum recording while we are creating any of these resources. And 4K is obviously better, but that will be requiring more storage and so on. Now, even we are talking about the 8K Ultra HD coming up, but even the devices also have to, it's like you're playing color, but then the device is not having the color option. Accordingly, we have to look up. And now many of these content are also being disseminated through the DTH and all, like EPG Parshala. So if you have good quality resolution, then it will be solving for there also. But if it is low quality, then it will not be so much beneficial to be disseminated through those devices. And one more thing is, I think you're aware with this chroma key technology. Can I see some chats? Has this been discussed? Then I'll not go. But here it is green and blue color background that we use. Anyone can tell me why green or blue background is used in most of the studios, which we call as chroma key technology? Yes, what will happen if I take red? Anyone? See, here what we do is, okay, so I'll go slightly in more detail, because this is the one of the best available methodology right now, I'll say, because technology keeps on changing. So in 2013, when we started EPG Parshala project, we were like initial few videos, it's the same background. How many backgrounds can you, it will be like boring. And then in our content, we had to also put up text, animation, graphics. So I thought of putting the chroma key technology, and where the green can be made transparent with the help of software. So if it is green, it actually, what we do is we remove the color. So if you remove green from your entire video or still, what you get is the transparent part wherever the green is there. And then we are left as the cutout. Right now, even this background, this is a virtual simulation of that type of, there is no chroma background, but it is trying to see the difference between my appearance, which is closer to the laptop, and the background. So it is able to make the background go into transparent. So this is slightly a different technology, which Zoom and now many other of these video conferencing tools are using. But in camera recording, it is best, and with chroma, you can do it with best quality output. You take the green background, and the green background should be having the same color. So that's why no shadow should be there. And once it is recorded, you put up in software where the green can be removed and it becomes transparent cut out of you. And then you have more space on left and right, and then you can write out visuals. At this stage, I will show you rather some video, and see, like, this is how we were sitting, and this is how it was finally in the video, where we could put up some backgrounds behind us and something in front. And even this table is artificial. So combining the virtual sets, which provide the virtual backgrounds and these tables and all, and with the chroma key, we came out with these good quality videos where we could add our subject specific requirements as well. So like, see, he's another. So this is one still short from that. And this is the corresponding visual that will be required. And while recording, we should be also improving on our delivery part. I think we have to be performers. So the skills like Hollywood or Bollywood actors are having, I think we can, because they cannot do our part. They cannot learn chemistry, physics, maths, Malayalam, Telugu, and so on. But what we know is, that's why in higher education, you cannot have anyone. They can talk about a 3-hour video movie where one or two dialogues are of that type. There are many videos where actors have posed up as chemistry or other teachers, but then no serious business. This is what is a very, very serious thing, that it cannot be done by any other professional but only us. So now it is our responsibility that we improve upon that. The voice modulation and how we behave in front of the camera, our confidence level. Otherwise, what happens is if you are very nervous or otherwise, we are simply reading from the screen. Look at when the output comes, the student will find it boring. Oh, everything is being read. Can I get the source of that file? So all these things have to be really mix and match, and you have to practice, and you can do the practice right in front with your smartphone. So let me show you some of the glimpses. It is chemistry, but don't focus on chemistry. Just look at what are the visuals behind and how the speakers are behaving, what animations, what sound effects all are being used. So this sound itself, we bought it. It was because we could not create something, but there are various sources where you can buy, and the pictures, the sound effects, and you can add in your videos in a very, very professional manner.
In the year 2018, the Nobel Prize in Chemistry was awarded to 3 scientists, as you can see here, Francis H. Arnold, George P. Smith, and Sir Fielder.
Next news is about researchers convert carbon dioxide into coal. This is a big development.
We all know that there are 3 key players in any teaching and learning situation. One is the curriculum, another is the teacher, and the third is the learner. But before we design the curriculum, there are 4 fundamental questions that must be answered by us. I would talk only about the pre-institution. One is of the constitution, which describes the entire philosophy of the constitution.
Hello everyone. The title of this module is Understanding Quantum Mechanics, a Chemist's Perspective. In our universities and colleges, we teach quantum mechanics, but somehow our experience shows that quantum mechanics is still a phobia for both teachers as well as students of chemistry. The next question is, what is the role of quantum mechanics?
Well, we can grate the juice of raw turmeric or ammonium thiocyanate, you get a blood red color. To that, add your fluoride solution, immediately the color will go. And why does the color glow? The blood red thiocyanate.
Electronic configuration.
After excitation, what? When a system, be it a molecule or atom is excited into an electronically excited state by absorption of a photon, it can undergo a number of different processes
for you to know. So let us start to look at the major pioneer.
Distinct documentary and the most famous experiment which was carried out by Sir Ernest Rutherford. There were limitations of this atomic model, and as you are aware that those were overcome by Niels Bohr.
Meter and candela, they have been already defined in terms of some physical constants.
All the SI units henceforth will be based on the fundamental constants. And as you can see here, you have got kilogram. Now that will be based on the Planck constant, the unit of light in terms of the quantum efficacy.
The UNESCO has decided to celebrate 2019 year as the International Year of the Periodic Table of Chemical Elements. We have completed 100.
And it is proven in these studies that the high intake of trans fatty acids is associated with increased cardiovascular diseases.
So that's why deep fried things like samosa.
Only thing.
And
deep and repeated.
Repeated ones. Right. Yeah.
So what we say, a junk food, basically a junk food which is rich in.
So like I'm talking about fats and oils, the chemistry part, but then I could also say the same words which doctor is saying, but he's saying is will be having a more sincere impact on the learner. So what happens inside our body when we take these trans fatty acids and so on? So we can be now creative that what interviews, what thing around our learning, teaching learning of that particular topic will be added as videos and will bring flavors.
Fat, basically a saturated
in the 6th century BC.
Nucleophilic substitution, most important
computer and the experiment.
So typically you can have solids, as you see the structure shown on the left, you have atoms which form bonds, and these bonds are of the order of few angstroms. You can have three-dimensional connectivity as on the left, and layered structures like in graphite shown to the right, and these kind of solids can be studied using X-ray diffraction
that are used.
Many a time students are heating solvents like.
So this is a proper animation which I created before recording, and that was being played, and then I was explaining that part.
Ethanol, which can easily catch fire, and in spite of giving proper instructions, they may be doing not in water baths but directly. So obviously ethanol being flammable, it will catch fire. The next symbol I am going to talk about is the flammable symbol, and you can see here the symbol represents the symbol of a flame. So what are these chemicals on which bottle you will find this symbol? These are the chemicals that catch fire easily under a given set of conditions and must therefore be used with utmost care. And how, as chemistry teachers and students, you can come to know what's all happening inside a pharmaceutical?
Pharmaceutical chemistry.
It is the most easy to install and then you have seen we have used some interesting questions also in between the modules to break the monotony. So it's all now new ways how you can integrate questions and the other learning outcome. I'll also show you some creative video which we have put up as
on cancer fundamentals. This course has been specially designed to create awareness amongst all the students of schools, universities, and colleges. It will also be very useful for social workers and field university of Delhi with the help.
Interact with people who touch you in the informed quest of cancer.
And here we have one character.
Understanding the word cancer and its types, importance of awareness and screening, which helps in early detection. In addition, we will be talking about the commercial.
So, all different ways. And there is one character, Koshika, also that we have added. I'll show you that part here. Yeah.
Is made up of systems, organs, tissues, and cells. Let me introduce you to the smallest unit of our body. I have with me Koshika. And by the way, Koshika means cells. Hi, Koshika. She may be the smallest, but she packs a powerful punch.
Hello, everyone.
Hi, Koshika. Good to see you with us. She's going to be with us throughout this learning process.
Yes, of course. I am so excited. Thank you. So are you ready to learn a little bit more about how our body and cells work? So let me open up myself to you and explain my body parts. My body parts are called organelles. These organelles are my nucleus, which is a control center.
This is another format of putting text as scribe video. So innovatively, you have to combine, as I told you, a fifth class student with character. But here we have used the character, and that too with a serious kind, a cell called as Koshika. And then throughout the learning, in between, she is making remarks to make the learner's attention grabbed and take it further. One more sample I will show is the this is the training videos we prepared for Delhi Police training of officials, where they wanted to know about the introduction of entire forensic science. So there were different categories. They told we want 1 hour video, and it would be, have been really boring had it been into the same speaker just talking, no visual. So just try to see the visual impact. And we introduce one character who is the forensic scientist, and he is staying in between gaps to make it more interesting. And then we are having different speakers coming up.
Hello and namaskar. We are a team of forensic scientists, and in this module we are going to introduce the subject of forensic science to you. To begin with, you might be eager to know how the term forensic originated.
The term forensic has originated from the word forum, which during the times of ancient Roman Empire meant a public place where the Senate used to conduct its meetings. The Senate was primarily concerned with the legal matters. And for this reason, forensic science is broadly defined as the application of science and technology to criminal and civil laws. The forensic science basically deals with the knowledge of science and technology to regulate the rules of law that govern the modern complex society.
Now, let us know the scope of forensic science and what are the various branches of forensic science which have emerged in the recent times.
Court of law. Forensic science has developed many of its own branches.
Branches of forensic science,
such as bloodstain pattern analysis, fingerprinting, voice analysis.
Evidence may be recovered from a contagious area. For example, a dining room adjacent to the bedroom where the murder took place. Steps in crime scene management. Note taking should be continuous to give evidence that the photograph is a correct and exact picture of the crime scene at the time it was taken. Crime scenes, according to scientific
physical evidences also play important role both in the crime investigation
and its explosives.
So this was another example, and now you can see that the key to making good videos is it should be interesting for the learner. So how you break the monotony, because even in your classroom you have challenges after 10 to 15 minutes. If you are just keep on speaking and speaking from one side, it is not interactive. So in videos it becomes manifold, because the students are not even sitting in front of you. And if it is really interesting, then it will be watched again and again, and the learners will be really glued to the subject, and the slow learners can watch it again and again. And yes, it will be useful. Some more, even some models can be shot, like look at here, I often use in my so I talk about how they are superimposable or not, and that clarity is there when we use models rather than just talk. So the physical models can also be recorded and used. And some minimum idea, not the professional, but some minimum editing we can do as teachers. We can do the screen capture, we can do minor editing, and put up our videos as interesting ones for our learners. So there are linear editing, there are non-linear editing, where you have multiple layers. There is raw footage, and you add backgrounds, you add visuals. So all that goes into, and there is also vision mixing, where there is a live production. Mostly this part is used when you have these TV news coming up. And when you're watching these Hollywood, Bollywood, and even TV news, try to see what feature can be used, which is some are very costly. Even I keep on looking at that. But then something which can be done by mix and match of these existing tools, and they become very, very interesting in our. So like vision mixing, we had used in our many of the videos now, where we have the virtual stat technology, and live we can show the PPT, we can show the speaker, we can have the background, and we can have all the panning, zooming on, and the ticker moving on, that who is the person. And then but then there are challenges. It cannot be done with live type of news, because what comes there, it is something generic topic which can be, but here it has to be really pre-planned. There cannot be any factual error or typo error, and the team has to be in that way. So post editing really makes very, very important factor here. Live editing, it can be done as a base, and then later on added with other things. So based on, we have this ARPIC program, which is from two times we are running. And here in ARPIC, both of these programs I have used extensively, all these, this cancer awareness and many other projects that we are doing. And so you can see the visual treat that we have tried to give around the chemistry teaching, and some of the popular video editing softwares you can try putting your hands into. DaVinci, FCP, Adobe Premiere Pro, Avid, and so on. But then while doing so, we have to be also very, very cautious about IPR and copyright issue. So a detailed knowledge of that is required. And then Plagium tools can be used to check up the video scripts, and also they can be used for your assignments of the students. And then what can be used with proper care are the fair use guidelines in our teaching learning and the e-content production. So what are open education resources? What is the Creative Commons license? So all that can be. And let me tell you that you can be now forthcoming that if there is any existing video, you write to the original video creator. And even we had written many mails to some of the high-end animation which were available, like why to recreate, because we were not even having so much funding. So, and we got permission from 90% of them that yes, you can use it in your videos, but then still you have to mention the source. So don't cut their original name, take the video full and go, give full credit to them. And that's another way you can approach and take our learning better. Some open educational resources which you can freely use, you should be aware. And many outside India also government projects, there are open educational resources which can be used in your own situation and context. So as teachers, you should now know what are these resources available and then try to integrate and mix and match and create your own creative virtual learning environment for the student. And all that can be hosted on learning management system. And you should know how to handle these tools, how to upload video, how to share video, how to add up your notes or PPTs or PDFs or your quizzes and do the analysis. So all that is possible. And you can also focus on more of the missing, or the gaps in the education system, because our aim is to develop holistically, the learner who is a responsible Indian citizen ready to work globally. So are we able to, through our chemistry, physics, maths, our own subject context, can we add those type of projects, those type of things which will, so videos will really help us decrease our time of delivery of what we have been doing in class, that plus something more which was missing through group projects, through more interactions, through preparing them, giving them confidence and awareness. Why not about the society issue, about the environmental issue, how the industrial application, how the work requirement are there in their own context. All that can be added and discussed and that will be possible when we adopt the ICT empowered pedagogies like flipped learning, where you give the videos to the learner and in classroom you discuss problems with them, not other way around that we just share the information is now plenty with them. And if you feel that okay, this is not available as I do, then prepare your videos, lectures by mix and matching, give them, and then in the classroom you do the problem solving them, and that is what is going to give them more confidence. And these are the ICT. So during and post COVID, higher education is, I think we are all witnessing the positive revolution we are going through, the transformation we are going through, which from most, almost two decades, Government of India and various state governments have been trying to put ICT into place. But I think as teachers, our attitude had to change. And with this COVID, I think that change is there. And we should really use this in a very positive way so that we prepare ourselves for the better post-COVID situation. So right now, although we are debating about the better methodology for virtual teaching learning, we have to also see how virtual and augmented reality can be integrated and how we can prepare towards AI-driven personalized, because one-to-one is the best teaching learning. But here, don't think that the teachers are not there. Many teachers helping to help not only this learner, but massive number of learners. So that's how we'll be able to, and that also with the quality. So I think I'll request all of us, we should keep on improving ourselves and keep on preparing the quality content, and you can integrate these videos in your classroom teaching, and we can take this really, really in an exciting way in our education spaces. So with this, I welcome to all of you to join the Telegram group if you have to take the further, on 27th, I'm starting a program, 1 week FDP, focusing into in detail knowledge. It's all hands-on on Word and Excel. So those who think they know Word and Excel, I think 90% of you may not be actually knowing. So what are the professional formatting required? What all tools and these words and even the encryption and the saving, how we have to do in this digital space, all we will be talking about. So thank you everyone. And if there are any questions, I am here. Thank you.
Good morning, ma'am. Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yes, please. Yeah.
Ma'am. I'm Dr. Ajay Kumar, Assistant Professor, Department of Physical Education, College of Engineering, Trivandrum, Kerala.
Okay.
And ma'am, my question is actually you're taking a wonderful class, and I appreciate your presentation and the language you used. It's wonderful, ma'am. And my question is now. It is IT era. So at what age should the students should be in front of the computer? And
I got your question actually. Yes, see in
so-called new digital era.
Yeah,
see. In that context.
Yeah, you're very right. It has to be a balance between how much time we give in front of these screens. And also the physical activities which are required, and what better than coming from a expert from physical education like you. So, but don't you feel that there are some things which we as teachers do repeat it? So if in even your physical education context, when there is some sports injury, if it can be related to some experts from bio talking about what is happening, or a physics person talking about that, how the movement is happening and how it can be related to physics. So it can really bridge the boundaries. But yes, I fully agree that we should be not exposing our younger kids into that. And that's why if you look at the SWAYAM is 9th class onwards only. There are no MOOCs which Government of India is preparing below 9th class, because it has to be more interaction. But that also will be the hybrid model. In our classroom, when the face-to-face students are in front, when the students are coming in your ground, now can you use these videos in between to show them and then put up in them into action? So that's what I think the new pedagogy of delivery, whatever teaching objectives and the we have to meet as teachers and the learning outcomes we have to ensure from our students, from our own subjects, have to be mixed and matched. So it's a new creative and innovative way where technologies can be used. And yes, there will be challenges always. Every technology has positive and negative things, and we have to be working around that as well. So fully taken your point.
Okay.
But I think you also know a 6-month kid is now using smartphones better than what we are doing.
You know, that is having its own side effects also.
That is a side effect, yes, definitely. But see, in China, they are telling their fifth class student to learn coding. So then, where will we stand? So we have to do a mix and match, yes, a balance of all these things, you know.
Okay.
But definitely not at the stage where we as teachers, 99% of us work in the COVID time.
Yeah.
We all have to now integrate and evolve. So that is what right now I think we should focus on that, and then later on parallelly we can be looking at the ways we can also handle. Right now we are okay, I think lacking on those.
Thank you ma'am.
So let's prepare that edu Hollywood around us.
Okay.
Anandra sir, can you wait for the thank you?
Paranjolo.
Okay, respected Vimla ma. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Am I audible? Okay.
Yes, please.
So, Vimla ma'am, and my fellow participants, now we have reached the very fag end of our 2-week online FTP. And when I first joined the course, I was really a bit confused about why or how 3 different institutions are collaborating in organizing a faculty development program. But all those doubts were cleared after attending the inaugural session where Vimla ma'am came up with the idea of how GAD TLC is actually supporting the various institutions of the country in organizing faculty development programs. Today she has given us a very valuable session on online teaching. She gave us some tips on how to develop e-content, then how cautious we have to be because we'll be reaching both, because there's a possibility and also the risk of reaching worldwide. And she also suggested that these tools should only empower us but not replace us. Then again, an overview was given with regard to the skills required in audio and video recording, voice modulation, performance, etc. And finally, she also said how with creativity, how with the help of various animation tools or various editing tools, we can enliven our online teaching platforms. So all in all, it was a very knowledgeable session, equipping all of us to the new online platform. On behalf of all the participants of this course, I thank you, ma'am, for your very inspiring and very insightful session. And I'm very sure your positivity and your energy will keep this mission going. All the best to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
A word of thanks to the coordinators of the program. We have attended so many refresher courses and we all know how they normally go. But this one was really different. It was really refreshing in its depth, width, and variety. So on behalf of all of the participants, I take this opportunity to congratulate the coordinators who chose the various topics as well as the resource persons for that.